These incidents occurred over a period of time when I was younger, however, it was only until recently that I connected the dots. I grew up in Louisiana, right on the outskirts of New Orleans. The city itself has so much history, myths, and intrigue surrounding it, that I would be remiss to say that I didn't have other experiences involving spirits and all that, but that's a story for another time. Right after Hurricane Katrina, I was displaced by the storm and ended up staying in Florida for a little while. While there, it seemed as though every channel on the news had coverage on the horrific event. People's houses were flooded, the roads were blocked, businesses were destroyed, and to make things even worse, there were many reports of people committing some heinous crimes. Part of the news covered people trying to escape the storm and the resulting aftermath, and the other half seemed to cover the dark side of humanity, vandalism, theft, looting, violence, all of that occurred while others were simply trying to survive. To make matters worse, the prisons were destroyed and a lot of the city's unmentionables started roaming the area, causing more trouble for the people who were trying to survive. Some really, really horrible stuff went on. Like, sure, this experience involves the aftermath of a horrible storm and the possible encounter with a dangerous cryptid, but I'll never put it past humans to be the darkest, most cruel creatures in existence. The news covered up a lot of it, of course. This is where people begin to say, then how do you know what really happened if there was a cover-up? And to you, I'll say this, I was there in the Superdome. I hid from the prisoners when they broke in, and I, being one of the able-bodied people in the area, had to help deal with the people who weren't as fortunate in being able to hide. Coverage about the swamps flooding, animals escaping the zoos, as well as creatures from the buying areas, alligators, and such, made their way into the same broken streets as the ones where people simply trying to get back to their homes. The news covered this as well. It seemed as though all manners of beasts were displaced from the storm, not just us humans. But what about the things that we are told don't exist? Is it possible that the storm impacted them as well? Flash forward to a few months after the storm. I eventually moved back to Louisiana and tried to put back the pieces of my life. I lost a dear friend to looters, my house was in shambles, and the majority of my classmates were off in different cities. Thankfully, I started dating my now wife. From Florida, we would take turns visiting each other every other weekend. It was a long distance thing, but we made it work. This is relevant to the story, trust me. One week, as I was driving my sister home from the movies, we started talking about lions. She was 13 at the time, and she just got out from seeing the Narnia movie with her friends. We crossed the small bridge over a canal that led into our subdivision, and as we turned the corner, she said something along the lines of, "And Mr. Tumnus started to play a flute and..." "Wait, what's a Tumnus again?" I asked. "He's this goat man thing, Kuya. Kuya is Tagalog for older brother." She saw my confused face and continued, "He's got like the legs of a goat, but he has horns and doesn't have any hair on his body, like Phil, you know, from Herku." She paused mid-sentence. "Ewa. Did Ashley get a new dog or something?" And motioned towards our neighbor's yard. I glanced to the left and saw what looked like a grayish dog, sort of like a greyhound, sitting in their front lawn. Something about it didn't feel right. It was skinny, like a little too skinny. Its muzzle looked too flat, and its legs were longer than I thought they should be, but I was no dog expert, so I didn't think much of it at the time. "Not sure," I said, as we drove past their house, "but I'll ask her later." We drove off with it looking in the direction of my car, almost as if it were following us with its eyes, but I figured that's what animals do, and cast it off as nothing. In passing, I texted Ashley, asking her about her creepy new puppy Dash, but she had no idea what I was talking about. She said that it was probably some stray that got a whiff of her dog's. "Poor thing was probably malnourished if it was as thin as you described," she said. I just wrote it off as whatever and forgot about it entirely. A few weeks later, I was on the phone with my girlfriend, just talking about our respective days at school, as I walked into the kitchen to grab a Coke. Robin, my sister, was browsing her friend's MySpace pages and listening to Lil Wayne on Pandora. Soon as I walked into the kitchen, I could barely hear what my girlfriend was saying, so I asked Robin if she'd lower the music, to which she begrudging did after muttering to herself. I grabbed my Coke, a whole bag of chips, don't judge me, and was making my way back upstairs when I heard Robin call to me. Kuya, she squeaked, as I rounded the steps. What's that? What do you mean? I heard something from outside. I groaned, told my girlfriend to hold on a moment, as I went back down into the kitchen to see Robin peeking out through the blinds. Ewa. That dog is back, she said, closing up the laptop and heading towards the stairs. I'll be in my room, that thing gives me the creeps. Sure enough, there it was, sitting at the edge of our property. Trying to sound tough, I told my girlfriend I was going to go outside to scare off the dog and that I'd call her back. In reality, I wanted to see the thing up close and bring it some food if it wasn't hostile. However, if it was hostile, I didn't want her to hear me scream like a baby. I opened the sliding glass door that led towards my backyard and proceeded to walk over to where Robin saw the dog sitting. Now, to get an understanding of our backyard, it had a cement patio that connected to the grass and, at the very end of the yard, was a canal. We had cement bases for a fence, but due to the hurricane all work stopped there. As I approached closer, its gaunt silhouette started to make me feel uncomfortable. It did that thing with its eyes that nocturnal animals do when they reflect light, you know, dash making it look even more unsettling. I took a deep breath, and was about to let out a hey boy, you hungry, but before those words could leave my mouth, it quickly jolted up and turned its head back towards the canal. For some reason this caused me to freeze, I mean, the way it moved was, off. It let out this moan or maybe it was a growl. It sounded like the combination between a dog's howl and a goat bleeding, but more melodic if that makes sense. I saw its eyes flash that eerie glow again as it spun its body around and darted down towards the canal. It was creepy, sure, but once more I wrote it off as whatever. Fast forward another week or so, and one of Ashley's dogs was found dead in her backyard. Now, I didn't see it myself, but from the way she described it, the poor thing was torn to shreds, with pieces of its fur scattered all over. The general consensus was that a bobcat or some other wildcat, but she wasn't convinced. Jacques was a mastiff, she kept repeating, there was no way some bobcat got to him like that. Now I know what you're thinking, it's probably related to the thing, right? It was outside of her house that one night, too. I mean, the thought crossed my mind, but I didn't want to bring it up around her. Later that same day, I was sitting on my roof. I would crawl out of my window from the second story and recline on the rooftop that hung over the garage, giving me a good view of my neighborhood and telling my girlfriend about all that has happened so far. How I kept hearing strange sounds at night, and about how Jacques was found dead. I was in the middle of telling her how these sounds have been increasing in occurrence these past few days, when I heard it again. It sounded louder, and much closer. Before I could ask why if she heard it as well, she asked, what the hell was that, confirming that she heard it too. I then proceeded to tell her my theory on how it was connected to the creepy dog. When the weekend came, and my girlfriend was in town to visit, I took her and my sister out to dinner. It was a nice meal: steak, potatoes, soda. The latter is important because none of us had any alcohol during this meal. On the drive home, we were discussing the intricacies surrounding religion and faith, blah blah blah, when Robin screamed, what the expletive, pointing to the roof of a nearby neighbor's house. In my shock, I slammed on the brakes to get a better look. That's when we saw it, like, really saw it. It was slender, almost to the point of absurdity, and its limbs were outstretched, joints bent in some unnatural posture. It had pale gray fur. No, it wasn't fur, it was skin. Its skin was pale gray and stretched extremely tight over its body. It was extremely unnerving to look at. I sat there, foot on the brake, as I tried to make sense of what it was. My sister screamed, "Go! I want to get home," and the creature froze. Wait, I thought, did it hear us? No, there's no way it heard us. The creature twitched, turning back to face us, once again hitting me with the eerie glow of its eyes, and then it skittered like the way a lizard does, body close to the surface over the other side of the roof, towards their backyard. I quickly called my neighbor soon as we got home and told him that we saw something on his roof. In an attempt to not sound crazy, I said that it looked like he had a huge possum crawling around the second story. His reply shocked me. Was it looking like a monkey? Wait, what? And no, it was. The wife and I have been seeing this monkey-looking thing hanging in the trees at night. We called animal control and they said it was probably some possum done escaped from a preserve, but I know what a possum looks like and that thing ain't no possum. I was more than a little confused, I guess. I mean, it looked like a long, skinny dog or something. We just saw it, CRA. That's the one, lil man. That's the one. Don't you worry, though, it just sits there staring at nothing. I figure if it means any harm it would have done so already. I guess, I said, well, I just wanted to let you know, it's pretty weird looking. Ha ha ha, he laughed, well if it come in here I'll knock it dead and mount it on my wall. And that was the end of it. Epilogue. Flash forward to a few weeks ago, early 2020. My wife, the girlfriend from the story, and I ended up moving to Florida, became parents, and were living the good life when my sister and parents came to visit us for the weekend. While the grandparents were enjoying putting our daughter to sleep, Robin suggested looking for creepy videos on YouTube. We're horror buffs, so why not, right? We came across a few horror story channels. I even introduced them to your channel, Darkness, when we came across another YouTuber. For whatever reason, I shall not disclose his name because I don't know how copyrights and intellectual properties work, but I digress. He had a numbered list of the creepiest things ever caught on camera. It went through various ghost sightings, unexplained occurrences, and even dabbled into the unexplained creature territory. The YouTuber started to talk about the rake, some creepypasta creature. As with the other items on the list, it had some photos and videos attached, all of which looked like whatever, that is, until it came across this one photo, a photo of a long, emaciated creature, sitting on all fours. Almost as an aside, Robin said, that looks like that thing we saw on the roof. Remember that, do ya? I looked up and squinted. Yeah. Kind of. Heh. I'm surprised you remembered that. No, she's right, my wife added. I remember it as well and it did look very similar to that. We laughed it off as a strange experience and proceeded to watch the video, which more or less said, supposedly the rake lives within deep forests. Reports have also sighted the creature in places like Louisiana. We all froze. The hair on the back of my neck stood up, as it all came crashing back. I looked up to see my wife and Robin in similar instances of awe. Holy crap, I said, now that is creepy. The video proceeded to show more convincing footage of the rake, with glowing eyes, via a video from a sewer tunnel. I know you know the video I am talking about. As I watched it, though, I started to feel uneasy. Those eyes, they pierced through me. I mean, that's exactly what I remembered staring back at me from way before. Yeah, so that's even more creepy, I started, because that's how I remember the eyes Ludash. Then the creature in the video then ducked out of view, moving in the same fluid, yet jittery, motion as it did on the roof. My wife and sister froze, both visually shaken. This sparked a big discussion on cryptids and the like, ending with both my wife and sister telling me to share our story. Someone has to know something, they said. A thing I forgot to mention earlier was the smell. There was always this dry, musty, rotted smell lingering in the air whenever we remember seeing it, but I could you find anything that talked to about how the rake smells? I was 12 years old when I went on really encounter the rake back home. We had it possible that there's more than one out there and our stuff ready? I mean, we went else to a good area somewhere in California. It's hard to explain. Spot we always featured in that video, which was a little dirt now with some little trees around and those eyes. But when we got there, I immediately felt that there was something wrong. Not at all. The whole forest, especially once you've seen it on your neighbors, there would be birds, bugs, and a whole lot of stuff. But all there was silence except for the leaves and twigs under our boots. We arrived at the mound and started waiting for a good buck to back, but nothing came. About an hour after we arrived at the mound, we started to hear the familiar sound of leaves crunching. You hear that? I whispered. Yeah, my dad said. We kept hearing the leaves and then out of nowhere a horrific scream. I jumped really hard and so did my dad. After we heard the scream, we decided to get out of there. We started walking, always keeping an eye out for whatever the thing was, and then I saw it. A tall man, except it wasn't a man, it was way too big, about 8 to 10 feet tall, and had paper white skin that was so tight on it that you could see every last bone, bony long fingers that had giant claws. Its face, oh man, its face was horrible. It had black beady eyes and a triangle shaped mouth that emitted another horrible sounding scream. Me and my dad hightailed it out of there with the creature staying right behind us. We got to the truck and looked behind us at the tree lean and saw the thing just standing, and then it walked back into the forest, never to be seen again by me nor my father. Easy to say I could have been snatched up by that thing so easy that day, and I'd say I'm pretty lucky to be alive.